As Mole walked back from Toad Hall later that day, his mind was in turmoil. How could Toad, that exciting and excitable animal, have got himself into such a sorry state? Mole recalled the many hours he'd spent with Toad over the years. No matter what he was doing, Toad was always smartly dressed to the point of parody. Mole especially remembered Toad's obsession with large motor cars and how he always dressed the part. Large check overcoat and cape, an overall linen dust coat, a matching cap, worn back to front, and goggles. And all of this complemented with a huge pair of yellow leather gauntlets. At the time, Badger had pooh-poohed Toad's appearance, saying that he looked a guy and that no respectable animal would be seen dead with him, but Badger was wrong. Mole thought he looked extremely dashing and compared his own rather somber black smoking jacket, which he habitually wore, to Toad's gay apparel. Mole realized that Toad's ill-kempt appearance represented a serious internal change in his spirits. His previous smart and sometimes dramatic wardrobe represented and demonstrated the élan and joie de vivre of that singular animal. The bounce and swagger were perfectly displayed by loud tweed jackets, ample plus fours, and the whole set off with a pink Leander Club bow tie. So what did it signify about Toad's emotional state that he was unwashed and ungroomed and wearing a sweater stiff with food droppings? And if Mole dared admit it, Toad, who always used a good cologne, was a bit smelly. Later that night, after their supper, Rat and Mole were sitting in front of a glowing fire, toasting their toes and sipping mugs of hot toddy. Mole had, of course, told Rat all about Toad and how he'd found him. Since then, the two friends had talked of nothing else. There was much tut-tutting and what can we do and what kind of caused it. Gradually, their conversation petered out as each animal sat staring into the fire, thinking his own thoughts. Eventually, Rat picked up the local weekly paper and thumbed through it in a desultory sort of way. Mole was half asleep when suddenly Rat sat bolt upright. "Mole, listen to this," he said in a commanding manner.
"Oh, Ratty, you're not going through the small ads again, are you?" said Mole sleepily.
Rat loved to see what bargains there were to be had, although he rarely found one.
"Be quiet," said Rat, in an unusually stern tone. "Listen."
Then he proceeded to read out the following advertisement from the Bankside Bugle.
"A qualified counsellor is now able to receive new clients. Animals who have personal problems which are causing them unhappiness or distress may care to make an appointment. Telephone Heronry 576.
"Well," said the Mole, who'd not been listening very attentively, "so what?"
"You perverse and foolish animal," said the Rat, not for the first time. "Don't you see? This could help poor Toady."
Mole was by now fully awake.
"Well, surely you're not saying that Toad is in distress, are you? It's probably just a stomach upset. You know how Toad likes his food and drink."
It must be admitted that Toad could sometimes overdo things, as he called it, and had been known to drink more than was good for him. Rat and Mole rarely had more than a dry sherry or a glass of beer and took a puritanical view of Toad's occasional bender.
"Nope," said the Rat, "although I don't claim to understand these things, being myself a simple and uncomplicated creature."
Here Mole coughed and spluttered into his mug and said it had gone down the wrong way.
"But," the Rat continued, "I'm very worried about Toad, and I propose that you and I visit him tomorrow. I'm worried that he might do something silly."
Although the Rat did not explain exactly what he meant by these words, both animals exchanged anxious looks.
"What's more, I think we should show Toad this advertisement about counselling and make him go."
"Well, do you think he would?" asked Mole. "After all, he can be a very self-willed and stubborn animal with a mind of his own."
"You're quite right," agreed the Rat. "But if he's in the state of mind that you say he is, he will be putty in our hands."
With that, both animals retired to their beds, full of apprehension about the morrow and wondering how Toad would respond to their plan of help. For help him they would, whether he liked it or not. And so it was that on the next morning, after breakfast, Mole found himself once again hurrying along the path to Toad Hall, this time accompanied by the Rat. As they walked, they discussed yet again Toad's unhappy situation and what might have caused it, and how they would help him. Rat carried the newspaper which contained the announcement about counselling, although Mole had already memorized the telephone number. Suddenly, a deep voice somewhere to their left boomed out.
Ratty, my dear little man. And Mooley, what are you two doing here?
Mole almost jumped out of his skin, but Rat said, It's only Badger. And as they peered into the wood on their left, the striped head and then the rest of Badger appeared.
Well, Badger, said the Rat, what a surprise. I thought you'd be at home sleep.
They stopped him mid-sentence. I mean working.
So I was, said Badger. But I have some work to do here. In fact, it concerns a planning application, and as I'm a member of the district council,
Badger spoke these words in capital letters,
I thought I would walk over and examine the matter personally.
He then said in his kindly way,
But what are you doing here? You're both looking very serious.
There was a clearing in the woods, and the three animals sat down, and Mole, helped by Rat, told Badger the sorry tale of Toad and the state in which Mole had found him, and how, even at this minute, they were on their way to help that unhappy animal.
Badger looked grim. I'm not in the least surprised, he said. It does not behoove one to criticize one's friends, but...
Mole had been waiting for this but.
I have seen this coming for a long time. Toad, although he has many excellent qualities which I need not elaborate here, is essentially a weak and unstable animal, bereft of his friends who in the past have given him such good advice and told him precisely what he should do, he's let himself go and given way to silly and morbid thoughts. I shall therefore accompany you on your errand of mercy. He must be told in no uncertain manner to pull himself together.
Mole and Rat were heartened by Badger's positive manner and determination, and together the three comrades, arm in arm with Badger in the middle, walked purposefully towards Toad Hall. Fortunate Toad, help was on the way.